Namaste. Welcome to the next video of Machine Learning Practice course. In this video, we'll discuss data loading functionality of the sklearn library. Data loading functionality helps us to load training data in different formats for our experimentation. Sklearn provides a general dataset API that has three main kinds of interfaces: the dataset loaders, the dataset fetchers, and the dataset generators. The dataset loaders are used to load toy datasets bundled with sklearn. Then there are datasets on the internet which are large and are not bundled with sklearn. So dataset fetchers help us to download and load these datasets from the internet. And then finally, we have dataset generators that are used to generate controlled synthetic datasets with specific statistical properties. So we have loaders, we have fetchers, and we have generators. Loaders load small standard datasets that come bundled with sklearn. Fetchers fetch and load larger datasets. And generators help us to generate controlled synthetic datasets with specific statistical properties. Both loaders and fetchers return a bunch object, which is a dictionary with two keys of our interest. One key is the data and second is the target. So data, the data key has a feature matrix of shape n, n, and n is the number of examples and m is the number of features. And we have target, which is the label, and the label is a vector with shape n. On the other hand, generators return a tuple xy, where x is a feature matrix of shape n, m, and y is a label vector with shape n. And both of these feature matrix and label vector are NumPy arrays. So loaders generally start with load underscore, that is what the loader function start with. The fetchers start with fetch underscore, and generators start with make underscore. Loaders and fetchers can also return tuples. If we set return underscore x underscore y argument of loaders and fetchers function to true. Let's look at dataset loaders. There are 7 dataset loaders, and you can see that these dataset loaders are loading datasets that are comparatively smaller in sizes. So you can see that there is this iris dataset which has got 150 samples with 3 features and a single label. This is a classification problem. Then we have a diabetes dataset with 442 samples, 10 features, and a single label. And diabetes dataset is used to train regression models. Then digit dataset has 1,797 samples, each with 64 features and a single label. Then we have multi-output regression dataset, which is linear root dataset with 20 samples, 3 features, and 3 labels. Then we have load wine dataset or wine dataset with 178 samples, each with 13 features. And finally, we have a breast cancer dataset with 569 samples, 30 features each, and a single label. These datasets are bundled with sklearn, and we do not need to download them from the external sources. You can see that 5 of these datasets are used for classification, like iris, digit, wine, and the breast cancer dataset, whereas diabetes dataset is used for regression, and linear root dataset is used for multi-output regression. So there are other larger datasets that are not bundled with sklearn, but are available on the external sources like on the internet. And if you want to access these datasets, generally we need to download them on the disk and then load them from there. So sklearn fetchers, dataset fetchers, ease out that functionality for us. They download and load certain datasets from the external sources for us. So there are datasets like faces datasets with 400 samples but a very large number of features, like 4096 features and a single label. The total number of labels are 40, so it's a multi-class image classification problem. So then we have 20 newsgroup dataset, which is quite famous dataset for text classification, has 18,846 samples and a single label. The total number of labels are 20. Then we have people dataset, which is again an image classification dataset with 13,000 odd samples with about 5,800 features and a single label, but the total number of labels are fairly large. So it's a large multi-class image classification problem. So these are some of the datasets that are available in the dataset fetchers. Then this is the California housing dataset, which we will use quite often in this course. And this California housing dataset has 20,640 samples, each with 8 features and a single label. And since we are predicting the price of the house, it is a regression problem. And California housing datasets will be used. California housing dataset will be used for demonstrating a bunch of regression tasks. Then we have other very large datasets like KDD Cup 99 dataset with about 4.8 million samples, each with 41 features, and you know it is used for multi-class classification problem. Sometimes we do not want to use the standard training set, but instead we want to make a synthetic dataset with certain statistical properties, and sklearn dataset generators help us to generate these kind of datasets. So there are functionalities to generate datasets for regression and classification, also for clustering. So make underscore regression function produces regression targets as a sparse random linear combination of random features with noise, and informative features are either uncorrelated or low rank. So if you want to generate statistical control dataset, synthetic dataset, we can use make regression function, and here we can generate dataset with a single target or multiple target. We will see this function in action in the subsequent collab. Then we have bunch of functions for generating synthetic dataset for classification experiments. For single label, we use make underscore blobs or make underscore classification function. They first create a bunch of normally distributed clusters of point and then assign one or more clusters to each class, thereby creating multi-class datasets. We also have multi-label classification problem, and for multi-label classification problem where each sample gets more than one label, we have make underscore multi-label underscore classification function for generating random samples with multiple labels. And here we use a very specific generative process and rejection sampling so that none of the sample get zero label. And for clustering, we use make underscore blobs API for generating a bunch of normally distributed clusters of point with specific mean and standard deviation for each cluster. So these were three main interfaces provided by the dataset loader. Apart from that, there could be other external datasets that are not directly supported by fetchers. So for example, there is a repository called openml.org, which has got a lot of machine learning data sets and experiments that are uploaded by different people. And we can use fetch underscore openml API for fetching data sets from openml.org. Sometimes we might have our data in common formats like CSV, Excel, JSON, or SQL, and Pandas provides tools to read data in this particular form in these formats. Then sometimes the data might be in binary formats like .mat or .arff, and mainly used in scientific computing. And in such cases, we should be using SciPy APIs for loading the binary formats. If we have columnar data sets, and if you want to load those columnar data into NumPy arrays, we use NumPy or routines functionality. Then we have dataset.load files that is used for loading the text files, and this is specifically useful for text data where the directory name is a label and each file is a sample in text classification problems. So dataset.load_files is the API that should be used to load such kind of text dataset. So we'll be learning a support vector machine as one of the important classification technique, and support vector machines generally work with very large feature space, which is also sparse. So SVM uses some kind of a sparse format to store the training data, and we have datasets.load_svm_lite_files API to load datasets in SVM Lite and libsvm sparse format. Apart from text and numerical data, we might have data in form of images and videos, or also in form of audios. And sklearn also provides functionality to load this variety of datasets. For example, skimage provides tools to load images and videos in NumPy array, and SciPy has a WAV file reader that helps us to read a WAV file into NumPy array. So we can use these various functionalities for loading dataset depending on the format of the training data. So if you're managing your own numerical data, sklearn recommends using an optimized file format such as HDF5. HDF5 stands for Hierarchical Data Format version 5, and the HDF formatted dataset takes lesser time to load. And Pandas, PyTables, and H5Py provides interfaces to read and write data in HDF5 format. So that's it from the data loading functionality of sklearn. We will implement some of these functions in Colab, where you will get an idea how to use these APIs for loading training data from different formats. I hope you enjoyed and learned how to load training data in sklearn from various formats. In the next video, we'll look at the demonstration of some of these concepts through Colab. Thank you and namaste.